Good evening, everybody. Hello, wherever you are. It's Andy Roda here, and it is my favorite day of the week, and I'm sure you know why. That's because it's time for another...
The Shortest Recession.
Today is another very special session. I get to chat with one of my heroes and a person who has... means a lot, tremendously, to the dance community. So if you're ready to jump into this party, let's just get straight to it. Today on the Short and Sweet Session.
The Shortest Recession.
Ask any fan of dance music who their favorite male vocalist is. 9 times out of 10, it will be the one and only Robert Owens. With a career spanning more than 3 decades as a singer, songwriter, producer, and world-renowned DJ, Robert has not so much embellished house music as played a large part in defining it. He's here today for an inspirational talk about his journey growing up singing in church to becoming part of the defining pillars on which today's dance music is built. Coming up next. Guys, please help me welcome the one and only iconic, legendary Mr. Robert Owens.
Thank you for
that. Robert, there you are. First of all, thank you so much for being here, taking the time to hang out with me and hang out with us today. How are you doing? What have you been up to the last few months? I haven't seen you around because, guys, normally I get to see Robert. And not only does he have exquisite taste in music, but he has exquisite taste in fashion as well, because we bump into each other all the time at one of our favorite stores. But I haven't been able to see you the last few weeks. So how are you doing, and how is everything?
I'm fine. I've been doing good. I've been locked away writing and recording. Lots of nice demos and stuff. I've been playing a few of them on some live streams because of the COVID, we can't actually do parties right now. But it's been a pleasure to do a lot of the live streams and still connect with a lot of people from that perspective.
Wonderful. I mean, obviously, that's why when I first asked you to be part of this Short and Sweet Session, this is the reason why we can't go to the clubs, we can't go out and do our thing as we're normally used to. So
I think this is beautiful what you're doing, you know, connecting different artists, you know.
Thank
and much
you.
Respect to you, sir, for all that you've done for the industry as well.
We're trying. We're following in our big brother's footsteps. And as I told you briefly, that one of the reasons why I wanted to do this, and for the new peoples who are just watching, the reason why I wanted to do the Short and Sweet Session was not only to connect with colleagues, friends, and family, but also to, you know, keep the spirit up and keep the momentum going for us and keep ourselves inspired. But most importantly, for my own selfish reasons, was to that I get to tap into the minds of people that I admire and respect. And so you, with your vast catalog of music and your more than almost like 4 decades of music, I wanted to tap into the mind of Robert Owens, how it, like, I know that you started singing in church. Were you the guy in the front? Is that how you knew you were the guy, that you had a voice? Or how did it start for you?
I was actually in the background. I always wanted to be a singer. I think one of my moments in time that really sticks in my head about the church was I was a member of the Voices of Cornerstone in Los Angeles, which was Reverend James Cleveland's church.
Wow.
And Stanley, the director, got me to finally do a solo track. And I think I'm during a Sunday service, I made it through the first verse and then I just broke down. The whole motherboard was like, "Oh, that's all right, baby. It's gonna be all right."
Oh, that's sweet.
But it's like a shock, the whole turnaround of me ending up being a a lead singer, you know, because I always wanted to be in the background. But even before church, I used to like try to form groups with different people in neighborhoods and stuff wherever I stayed, with younger siblings whenever we would connect. I was always trying to get people together to form some kind of group. It's always just naturally been inside of me, the instinct to want to entertain.
Yeah. Did that come from a family of singers as well, that it was natural for you to sing for each other? Or were you maybe like myself, that I didn't get hurt as much, so I wanted to be seen in some way, or I wanted my, you know, I had this voice, but I wanted people to hear it. How was it like, was it for you?
I think I just naturally had an instinct to want to entertain.
Okay.
And I think the whole rejection thing from within the family environment of people telling me, oh no, you can't do it, you're never going to be nothing of this, that, and other. But why can't I? So I was always a person to challenge anyone if I felt something internally inside, you know, and I was driven from within inside, you know. It was something in there that was like, I have something to give. From one perspective, I've seen people try to put me down. And from another perspective, I've seen a collective of people just saying, it's something in you.
Wow.
I've seen them instantly smile and seen a joy in them from me entertaining them, dancing or singing, you know. And so I always gravitated towards that energy.
Mm.
Was feeling down or depressed by anything, I could always gravitate towards that energy of how I made people feel and the feeling I felt.
Wow. And is that how you got into DJing as well? So it sounds like a natural evolution of wanting to entertain, which is...
Well, actually, I was DJing first, but even back, like family gatherings and everything, as a child, different members of the family would always select me to pick the music. Oh, you know, you good at that, boy. Go on, you go on and put the section together. Even when we just had turntable, you know, I was still there putting the selections together at, you know, the picnics and all the different black club parties and stuff that, you know, a lot of the urban families would do back in the day, you know.
Yeah.
So it's just always been there around me. Even in normal jobs, co-workers would ask me to sing to them during working hours.
Mm-hmm.
Shipping and receiving, you know, a lot of people have asked me to sing for them there. I've been a nutrition assistant. They asked me to sing to them on the line. So it was always a collective of people that seen something in me.
Yeah.
And that gave me a drive to push, you know, and not be afraid to even venture out into other cities or traveling, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So much love amongst the streets that, you know, it was a natural instinct to want to investigate further and further and further.
Is that how I heard you say somewhere that you touched on it yourself, that you said that you had people, one camp saying that you're not going to amount to something, and then suddenly another camp saying that you could be something. And I heard you say somewhere that you were not that old, around 16 years old or something like that, when you actually ventured out.
But even something else to pinpoint on too, even in the educational system, this problem with a lot of young children. I can remember back, you know, coming up in within the educational system, me asking certain things, and it's like, oh, you don't need to know that. You stick to this or you stick to that.
Yeah.
You know, it's always been a formulated system within a lot of environments where people wanted you to do exactly what they felt.
Yeah.
And you were being bad or you were being disruptive if you wanted to know anything or question anything outside of their authority. And it was always a rebellion against this kind of energy, because like, you know, it's almost like knowing without knowing, you know. Even as a child, it was like, something's wrong with that. I don't feel that natural energy. My natural instinct is to feel love and to give and to connect.
Amen.
And see people happy. And that was all the way back from a child. So even if I've strayed away, even in later in life, I always could remember that kind of energy about me as a child, and I can always return to balance.
Did that come from your spiritual background? It sounds like a spiritual practice.
Naturally, you know, I spent a lot of time on my own. Mm-hmm. So even this whole Corona thing, it's not been like something mad for me because I spend a lot of time alone. Or else when you see me out, we connected when we out shopping or somewhere. I'm out walking or something. I enjoyed spending lots of time on my own, you know, because you get a chance to reflect, learn a lot about you.
Absolutely.
Think about your friends' conversations. A lot of my writing stems from speaking to friends. And, you know, it's not necessarily always my experience, but I could listen to your experience and I can feel a poignant feeling, you know, from just something you said. And that can trigger me to write.
Yeah.
You know, in return, I feel like, okay, I might have experienced that, or somebody else might have experienced that, and you try to share these energies. And this is another form of trying to connect, you know, for us to connect each other.
Yeah. Amazing. I want to play a first out of several tracks of your vast catalog of hits. and I wanted to bring on this particular because it's one of your... one of the early tracks from your group Fingers Inc. And interestingly enough, I saw in research for this talk with you, I saw a very, very wonderful interview with Larry Heard and heard his side of the story of how you met. And he stated that it was actually, it was like a very, you know, when you think of your union, it's like it's a divine moment in time that created the foundation of dance music. But the way he put it was like, yeah, it was just like a normal meeting between two guys. And I asked him, hey, are you making music? I heard you were singing. And that's how that was his version. What was your experience of meeting Larry the first time in the club? It seems like you met him in the club, right?
Like that, because the beautiful thing about like back in that period is... DJs, promoters, everybody, we were like a family. Most of us went around to each other's houses, and so it was relaxed. If somebody introduced you to someone that you respected, you automatically took them in without any judgment or anything because you valued your friend.
Yeah.
So it was natural, you know, and so he gave me some music, and then I went over to his house, and I think it was just instant.
Wonderful.
Certain tracks, and I was like, I have some words to go with that, and I have some words to go with that. And it was an instant connection and relationship where we just fell in sync with each other.
Amazing.
And I think it stemmed from the point of no judgment.
Yeah.
You know, we were there just fascinated with the wonderment of possibilities that could come.
Yeah.
You know, so it just naturally flowed. And I think those are the best sessions when you just go into the whole thing naturally and, you know, you respect each other, you know, and you're not judging one another.
And from the wonderment of possibilities, here is our first track for tonight, Mystery of Love.
Love is burning deep inside. It's in my heart. It's all up in my mind. I want a little love in my life. It keeps on burning and burning all up in my mind. Uh-huh. Mystery of love.
Come on, bass line. Come on, groove. Ah! Did you know at this time, it sounds like you said that you were just playing along, but did you?
I can't actually hear it on this side.
You heard it?
I can't hear the music.
No, you cannot hear. Because, guys, Robert... I'm grooving. Because, obviously, we're speaking through another medium, and it goes out through another medium. But it's... I mean, the bass line, this track is so amazing. Did you know at that time, or what was going through your mind when you created... Or how did you actually know that this was something special? You talked a lot about feeling.
He gave me, like, those tracks, Mystery of Love. We did the... A Path early. He gave me Can You Feel It, Washing Machine, a couple different tracks. And I played them in the music box where Ron Hardy, they asked me to cover Robert Williams, who was the owner running it. He asked me to cover for Ron because he couldn't come in that day. And I had those tracks, and so I played them. And I looked at the crowd, and it was like, I think I played them Mysteries of Love. I probably played about three times.
Come on.
It looked like it just hypnotized the crowd. And I was like, wow, something is in these tracks. You know, this guy really has something unique and different, you know, and special, you know. So it was a natural feeling. It was beautiful because I was in that circuit of playing at different pubs and places then, and had a strong friendship with Robert Williams, you know. And Ron Hardy and Frankie Knuckles were the main two big DJs for me at that time, you know. So I had a close connection with them and start giving them, like, even edits and stuff that I did of some of the tracks from Larry. And it just blossomed. It just bloomed, you know. So that's a period in my life that I'm really grateful for, you know, that I've seen a lot of love and seen a lot of people come together through the music from that period. But especially, too, for DJs like Frankie and Ronnie at that time, they gave us the opportunity, you know, to allow our music to be heard, you know. You know, they were playing some of these simplistic productions against full orchestral productions and stuff. People still just fused into the energy. Wow. And so it goes back to that whole principle that music is a feeling, and it's about a connection of the people. You can feel that.
Absolutely. And I think that's the magical thing about making music, and also what we have to remind ourselves as creators is, you know, you can quickly go into that left brain and be very functional and like, okay, it has to be this, it has to be cool or whatever. But it's really that initial emotion that when it really hits you, that almost like unspeakable emotion, that that is the one that permeates through beyond. Yeah. That's what it sounds like that you've experienced, that what you found.
Definitely,
And so, which brings me to this next song. Then you started doing, or you released a solo project, and this next song that I want to play is your top 20 hit, Visions. We're going to play a little snippet of it and talk about it. Here we go.
There's a mist of magic paper that scans my mind, making cells that have no image come to life, forming thoughts that just could make me my dreams delight. Vision inside of me, vision deep inside my dreams, gotta paint the way to set them free. They're in you, they're in me. Don't lose your vision. Don't lose your vision. Don't lose your vision. Don't lose your vision.
It sounds like that you were prophesizing about your own vision, and as well as reminding yourself to don't lose that vision. Is that what was going through your mind when writing this song?
Yes, 100%.
Yes. Well.
Yeah.
So you always, it sounds like you always, from a very early age, you had this, it sounds very corny, but it's true, this inner voice that you could hear very clearly, and you you operated from this energy, from this knowingness, and like you said before, the system that said you could not, that this voice was stronger, and it was from this you operated from.
Yes, definitely. Well, if you've experienced complete happiness, you just have to weigh out the two. Do I want to feel this bitter, drained emotion of always depressed, always worried, always looking for hope? Or do I want to actually experience and feel hope and translate that on to others and see others receiving it, and we all get that ah moment together? It's like in a studio working with musicians. It's at some point we do different things, and all of a sudden we get to points where we both go, ah, the four of us, whoever's there. You want to give that back to others when you finally receive that and you understand that, you know, why I want to be miserable? Why I want to be judgmental detracted from others? You know, you want to focus in on your uniqueness and add that uniqueness into the scenario. When you become a team, you become a team player. You're not judging or worried about other people's energy. You respect each energy that's there.
Yeah.
And you know that completion of all your energies together is going to make something else unique.
Yes.
And you're very happy about that, you know.
Amen.
And it's, you know, always trying to translate that kind of emotion to others, especially when I'm working with them. You know, I never want someone to be nervous or feel intimidated if they're in a project working with me. You're supposed to be your most relaxed and natural person that you are. And then you're going to want to give your all. And that's beautiful.
Absolutely. Amen. Reminder, kids. Reminder to self, actually. Note to self that is when you're operating from your highest power, when you're relaxed and in balance with your true self, not trying to impress or do anything to gain.
Emulate someone else or something that you've heard. You're tapping into your own natural, unique energy.
Amen. Amen. Which then brings me to your number one hit from 92 with maestro himself, David Morales. Let's hear a little snippet of I'll Be Your Friend. I have so many memories of this song. I was barely old enough to get into the clubs, but I did get in, and I did. I did get in, and I was
all been there. Huh?
Sorry,
we've been there at one point in time where, you know, it's like, oh, please let me in. Huh?
And it helps if you actually perform or you're doing something artistic. They're like, okay, yeah, let him in. Could you explain to me? I'm curious about your writing process. How I heard that you were carrying a book, a little black book with you. Is that how you create first? Is it lyrics, melody, or how is your creative process?
So I have a few different angles. Even when I worked in the hospital, sometimes I would complete my mission of whatever I had to do during the day very early and fast. I was sharp and quick.
Mm-hmm.
And I would go and hide in like private bathrooms, and then I'd write lyrics on toilet paper, even when I ran out of paper. And actually, I can just naturally make up melodies inside my head, you know. And then in other processes, a lot of people just send me a series of instrumentals, And it's reversed back to even Fingers Inc. I would just listen to different instrumentals and naturally would create melodies to go with that particular track. Mm-hmm. Even when working with Dave Morales, Fotech, a bunch of people, even Fotech, he sent me like a series of tracks. And I was like, I have some words that I think would go directly with that. And I've just kept that whole process to date, you know, when I'm working with different people. And I always react to my first instinct about something. Mm. And just natural with making up melodies for different tracks. Even some people have given me like just empty. One time someone gave me just a string and I had to do a whole arrangement around this string. I was like, okay, this is a challenge. Some people have given me like just a B track and maybe a slight bass line there or something.
Yeah.
And then just naturally create melodies. And sometimes I structure it in the 8, 16, 32, 64, whatever. And then sometimes I just free fall it and just go.
Mm.
And there's been times where I can just say hit record and just record what's in my head.
Yeah, yeah. But do you then write lyrically? Is this always from, is it something that you're going through at the moment, or is it a catalog of lyrics that you have like from years back? Or,
I have loads of books here of lyrics, mm-hmm. but often, you know, I could like go into a studio and think I'm going to go with this, this story that I've wrote, and then get in there and like, no, I'm feeling something else. So like hit the mic and then just go and create out of that. And this is where it reverts back to that whole emotion of feeling.
Yeah.
And you just have to catch the moment. And it's like I've said to a lot of producers that I've worked, please make a blueprint of your first experience with an artist. Even if you go and change, revert back to that feeling that you share together. And this is a point where you're respecting each other. Mm. And so often in this industry, you get in there with them, especially as the singers and the producers, it's like different worlds sometimes.
Yeah.
They get you in, they just want you to sing and then get out. And then they end up changing what you originally done and keep changing and changing till they're confused. And it goes all the way out of sync. And it's also the DJ and the music. It's going to follow chord progression and different things and hear where the voice is matching with the chords. But a DJ to sit there and just clip, not following your first instinct, if he's just flipping different things, eventually the voice is going out of tune or something. And it's like, well, the voice don't sound right no more. You didn't have blueprint of the original thing that we did to revert back to. You didn't sit there with a musician to try to see if the key was in the same key that the voice is in. You know, just the respect of having a blueprint of what that artist
intention,
the vocalist emotion, what he, you know, first gave, you know, because you went in there, you poured your heart out. Even if you're going to change it and do dubs or whatever, still have a print of that. Absolutely. And this is where I'm really grateful that I'm in control of recording my voice myself now. And in a lot of cases, and I give them a base kind of thought of my perspective of how I hear the vocal and the story. And then if you want to change it, fine. But at least for my own purposes of my own feelings, emotions, so many things I've done that have been just lost in history because people changed it or they deleted what I did. And people don't realize the amount of work that I've done. You see a catalog there, but it's hundreds and hundreds of tracks that I've done that have never seen light of day. There's hundreds and hundreds of tracks that's just sitting there.
Yeah.
I have vocals forever, you know, but you keep pushing on and you keep giving. And I think that's all you can do.
That's all you can do.
You don't let it define you anything about the past, but you should be aware.
Yeah, absolutely. I want to play another track of yours. a number 4 hit from 99 with Satoshi Tomie. and Kevin Fisher. And when I first heard this track, I really gravitated towards him, probably because now that I've been living in Berlin and you yourself always are also in Berlin, my taste has naturally changed or become more open. Growing up, I was probably more, I understood maybe more the classic house, etc. And living in Berlin definitely broadened my perspective to understanding the techno sound more. I'm not saying that this track is necessarily techno, but it has the flavor that I associate with Berlin. So here is Darkness.
Thank you.
Forces that exist, forces that be. Something beyond control has taken over me. I'm drifting, loving too hard, loving too fast. Something about those moments just never seem to last.
I'm drifting, y'all.
I'm drifting. Love left me standing by the open sea. Nobody there to comfort me. My heart is dry like a desert reef. At night the stars above are my only company.
Kids, imagine this on a large PA in a club. You'd be like, going in, honey. What is it about club culture that is so that pulls us in, or that has maintained or made you be in this environment?
For me, like, stay abreast, attuned with every evolving culture. I actually go out to clubs. Even if I'm performing, I stay and listen to other DJs play, you know, and I might be out there on the speaker jacking to you, you know.
Yes.
It's good to be evolving, because I look back at one time, house music was new. I remember going to England in the early stages of one of the first house tours over there. Mm-hmm. And we to clubs, even up in Manchester, Newcastle, where they were playing hip hop music, and then later they start playing house. But at first I heard the hip hop music and I was like, oh my God, I'm not going out there, they're gonna kill us. And just unification amongst, you know, different cultures, genres.
Yeah.
It was beautiful. So, you know, that always is something that's inside of me that helps me want to evolve in genres, you know. And I think, again, a feeling is a feeling. If you try to connect with any individual, any type of music is about you and those individuals connecting, you're going to come up with something unique. So I can work with anyone from any genre of music. Mm. And I've always tried to do that and tried to fuse different things, you know. I love even playing, you know, often I fuse like vocals into the techno. I started that when I first came here, you know, when people were, again, it was like, you can't do this.
Yeah,
and I was like, let's see. And then I seen the reaction of the crowd and I was like, you can.
Yeah.
And it's like, you can't let narrow minds from giving.
Mm.
You know, I walk in with this vision. I come to give you love.
Yeah.
You don't have to accepted, but I know what I've come to give.
Wow.
This is the area of my life where I can give unconditionally.
Yeah.
And you know, as long as I know that I've done that, I'm not worried.
Mm.
I mean, do your thing.
Having this zen about you, or this spiritual knowledge, what, aside from music, what do you feed your mind? Because it sounds like you have a deep spiritual practice to be able to maintain this unconditional love feeling and this no... I mean, since the first day I met you, there was just an aura and an energy field about you that was no judgment, inclusivity, pure love and humility, kindness, which many times in our business, it's not always easy to find people like
it's
that.
It's missing. Yeah. The thing is, like, you know, again, I've strayed off, and usually, you know, it's when you have the wrong, if you keep the wrong company in your life,
yeah,
you know, you become bitter when you know that you've come in with this natural reflection of this, what you see is what you get.
Yeah.
You know, not judging you. I don't want to know your history. I'm looking at this present energy that we have, and I'm going to trust that. And then when you're deceived, you know, and so often things just come in natural, and then you start building up all this negative energy and stuff, and it takes you so far away from who you naturally are. If you understand that whole balance,
yeah,
energy, calmness, peace, and wanting to give love, you know, you learn that, okay, get all of that out the way, and I'm right back there.
Yeah.
Often in life, you know, I've had to just like clear the slate and get back there to what's most important to me, and it's feeling that kind of energy.
Amen. Amen. Which leads me to this next amazing song, and I love the fact that we just spoke about how especially house music, it can be so, it's about unity and working with people across the globe. So you made this track Fly Free with our dear friend Ralph Gum, who's in South Africa. And there's many subgenres of house music, but particularly this style or this sound, Afro, which has been very prominent the last few many years, actually.
Yeah, well, for a long, long time.
For a long time, but it came to the, it came, became more.
They have festivals, 40,000-60,000 people about house music. It's on the national radio stations.
Yeah.
I've done their equivalent to like a Top of the Pops.
Yeah.
I mean, it was the love I received in Africa was overwhelming every time I've been there. You know, it was a shock. I think the first time I broke down and just cried.
Wow.
Because they asked me to play a track that I didn't even have it with me.
Mm.
And they was like, wait, they ran home and put it on a CD and brought it back to play it. And they sung the whole song over the speakers. I was like, just emotionally broke down. I was like,
wow.
Where people just show you constantly a negative perspective of what's going on, to go there and see a total difference.
Yeah.
You know, we were there, even we were doing parties in different places, German, French, American. We were all together and we all received love everywhere. You know, and that was like beautiful.
Amen. And like, I had. A few weeks ago, I had the brilliant Inaya Day at the Short and Sweet session, and she said that to many people, the dance floor or house music and the dance floor is the closest they get to church, and that's what it sounds like you experienced with all these different nationalities and just people loving on each other.
Mm.
So here is your track with Ralph Gum, Fly Free. Yes, sir. Fly Free by Robert Owens and Ralph Gum. Amazing. I have a last track before we're going to get into something very special. And it was a few years ago, I had the pleasure, the utmost honor and pleasure of actually being in the studio with yourself on Yanitavi's track.
Oh, thank you. Very much
called
too.
called the other man.
Yeah.
And we recorded this at the Red Bull Studios, and I remember that it was that it was such a loving session. And what you mentioned, what you touched on earlier, saying that you want people you're working with to feel calm and relaxed, and just, you know, we're here to exchange. That was exactly what I felt that afternoon recording with you. It was such a effortless session, and just pure joy playing and trying things. And I was like, Robert, can we try this? And you're like, yeah, sure, let's try it. It was just an honor to see you working and also being part of this track, The Other Man. So I'm just gonna play it for the kids out there to keep them up to speed with The Other Man. Here we go. Yes, sir. Robert, having such a vast catalog of songs that you've created, how did you learn how to, from a creative point, it sounds like it was so natural for you. It just came out totally natural. But there's another side for us being, you know, being writers, artists, entrepreneurs that no one teaches us in school. Where did you learn these skills to be able to maintain such a long career?
Never had a lesson. It was the frustration of someone, others telling me that I can't do it.
Mm. The rebel in you.
Yes. Yeah. You know, in every different angle of life that I wanted to learn about or achieve, if someone denied me knowledge about it, I went out and investigated.
Mm.
I wanted to see, it wasn't even a matter of proving them wrong. I was like, but wait a minute, if I feel this and say, let me just do a little investigation on my own, you know, yeah. Let me just try to, even like my first experience with trying to learn playing a piano, and I just start writing down a series of numbers and playing them, sitting there with a bottle of wine every few nights. I bought a bunch of equipment, and nobody wouldn't help me. And I started reading them manuals and then creating these number formulas. And one night I was like, oh, wait a minute, goddammit, that's a ballad going on there.
Wow.
With sheer will and determination, you can achieve anything your heart desires.
Amen. Amen. And that is really the nugget of why I wanted to do the show. As I told you, this is like my own little Jules Holland meets Oprah meets Think and Grow Rich, because before manifestation, thought precedes manifestation. Mm-hmm. And I find it very fascinating speaking to people who've had an impact on our culture and how... What was the mechanism that made them, first of all, believe that they could do it, and what thoughts were there to maintain this longevity? And it sounds like that you always trusted this. You heard the voice early on, and you always trusted it. That's what it sounds like to me.
It's the only place that never let me down. It was the only area within my life where I could give unconditionally.
Hmm.
And you know, it was never no hurt in that area, you know, so you always gravitate towards that kind of place. Hmm. Especially if you're a loner, or if you're a kid that more or less came up in the street kind of environment, you know, and more or less I kind of raised myself from a certain angle, you know, because of certain circumstances. But you know, it's beautiful because it taught me how to want to investigate more and want to be more fascinated with things that could be.
Yeah.
And the wonderment thing, you know.
Wonderful. Amazing, Robert. What could be and the possibilities. We spoke a lot about that today. And I thought I wanted to do something different on this short and sweet session with Robert Owens. The other night I was just playing, I was playing keys for the guests who wanted to sing. But I thought, I bet you Robert is game to try something different. So guys out there, we're going to try something for the first time. So hopefully this will work out.
Okay. Got to close my window so the neighbors don't.
We don't want to get we want to shower unconditional love on them after this as well.
Just a moment.
But let me just set it up for the guys out there. So I'm going to try to create a track from here where I'm sitting. And and Robert is going to sing live from where he's sitting. And hopefully this will be in sync and sound smooth for you guys out there. But before we do that, let me just see. I just want to tell you, the guys out there, if you have any questions for Robert or myself, please feel free to type them in the comments. And we're going to go through them after the song. So type in whatever you want and we'll get to it.
Yes, coming. Yeah, I'm here.
Could you, before we do this, could you say a few words about this song? This is such an iconic, amazing, heavenly song, Tears. What was this song about and what does it mean to you?
Frankie just got in touch with me. Satoshi Tommy wanted to meet me. I wanted me to sing on the song, and Frankie and Satoshi were working together. And he got in touch, and he actually came to Chicago and told me to come out. He was playing. He wanted me to hear the song, and I came out, and he played the instrumental, and I was like, oh, that's nice. And I was like, okay, I'll go back home and write something. And so I went back home and just thought about the melody of the song, and then wrote the words, and I let my mother and father see what I wrote, and they was like, that's interesting. So I called him after that and recited what I wrote over the phone, and he's like, oh, that's fine. I think a day later or 2 days later, they flew me into New York, and they ended up asking me just to stay there after that.
Wow.
So I became a part of the whole Death Mix crew.
Amazing. And I never asked you this before, but how was it actually? It sounds like this was another union of collaborators that was just like divinely put together, that was effortless. And or how was the process for you guys when you were working together?
Frankie was even before he had moved back to New York, in Chicago. We've always been like a family amongst all of us there. I said, like, we're Ron and everybody. Mm-hmm. A lot of the same crowd went around to each other's house. You might have had people that, I'm team Frankie, I'm team Ron, but overall, they were a family. Mm. And so I knew them both, and, you know, me recording stuff, you know, I would automatically go over their house and let them know about different things that I was doing. So, you know, I think it was easy for me to just move there and, you know, fall in sync with what was going on, because me and him had already been like a family, kind of like a brother relationship back in Chicago.
Mm, wow. Okay. Robert, are you ready for this? Sorry?
Or he was our godfather.
He was the godfather. Yeah, I mean,
godfather of the house. So
what I experienced myself later on in this culture was that there's many kinds of energies in nightclub culture and in dance music, but what I experienced in this particular was that, like you said before, it's very love. No competition. Of course, there is some sort of competition, but it's not what you see.
Well, certain people, you know, but certain people, I think I've met many other legendary older artists. We don't even have to go into that. That you know, you relax, they are, and you look at wow, those kind of entertainers,
yeah.
Their legacy and what they achieved, and they just are relaxed and natural around you.
Mm.
You learn to give that energy back, yeah. And that's also a reflection of how I am, because of the way some really great, huge artists treated me.
Yeah,
you know, and I give that back to others. Mm-hmm. It's like that torch, you keep passing it on and passing it on. And when you reach a certain level of understanding about yourself, it's you don't compare. When you walk in a room, you have no need to compare yourself to nobody.
Amen. Amen. Hmm. Let the choir say amen. That is a spiritual practice that it's a daily practice, basically, to remind ourselves about that. That is not a competition. And
lead them to the water, but you can't teach them how to drink.
Amen. And what also another reason why I wanted to do this, you know, to share insight with our peers, but also should there be, you know, youngins out there who wanted to pursue this career or this life, this is really the place that where I wanted to find people who could share that message of encouragement to particularly these young kids.
Well, I think it's beautiful what you're doing.
Thank you so much. I appreciate that. Okay, Robert, should we try to see if this works? Oh, I'm excited.
Oh.
Okay, so as I said, guys, this is the very first time we are doing this. And thank you, Robert, for being game and being down with this. I hope it works out. So if you don't hear me, it's because I'm doing something else. I'm gonna create a few tracks and then, you know, it's all yours. Okay. So guys, here we go.
Regretting nothing, I like my world. Over here. Oh, yeah.
Yes, sir! Yes! I have no idea how it translated out there. I hope it was, but well, who cares?
I hope it was all right.
It was love. I felt it!
Love, a loving place, yeah.
From a loving place, Mr. Robert Owens. Oh my God, that was so much fun. It was so nerve-wracking because of this technology thing. But thank you so much for being game and being down for trying it. I really appreciate that.
Thank you for having me here.
Absolutely.
Loads.
Before we go, I want to see if there's any comments or... yeah. So let's just see here. Rebecca says, nice to see you. All my love to you. Yanis sends us hearts. Annette Prudlow sends us love. Denise Jensen from the duo Anik. Karina and Denise are sending us love.
I send you all love, yeah.
John Elton says, thank you for such a wonderful and inspirational conversation. Love the good friends vibe. Like being home together with you. Robert, thanks for so many great tunes and such a deep vocal. It would be fantastic to hear you both share your thought about creativity and the scene and the amount of self-destructive behavior, addiction, drugs. Many artists like Gaga come our own being open with their own mental health issues. Have you any thoughts about these issues? Does it relate to creativity, talent?
Well, as artists, we have the opportunity to translate stories, you know, about a reflection of what's happening in our environments. Again, you know, I think I kind of pinpointed on this a little, having conversations with just people in general. That has a big reaction on how I might write a specific song, relating to something that's happening around my environment. But often in life, I've found that it's better to ask people to view something with you, and you take them out of a confrontational mode. Mm-hmm. A lot of societies these days, it seems like a revolving circle where people are constantly talking and jumping in the camps of stone them, but instead of actually coming up with solutions.
Amen.
yeah. and actually joining together with people and bringing up solutions. It's been too much talk in every area. If you actually want to really make a change, physically do something. But, and, you know, I've quoted this and said this, in a, and I've even recently put it in a song. What did I do today to help someone see life from a different perspective or a different viewpoint? And again, if I take you out of confrontational mode and ask you, let's view this together. You, a picture, you can take out the facets that relate to you, and maybe you will be touched by some facets that I acknowledge that you didn't see.
Amen. Yes.
It's like often I've had to meet people on their level and stuff, you know, but I'm aware of a lot of different things, you know, and it this reverts all the way back to the origins of human beings. You know, I actually study, and I've studied a lot, and, you know, you accept the truth. You know, you shouldn't be a move to just be bitter and keep going through the same cycle of what, you know, has happened with the world. You know, this is your opportunity to actually make a physical difference and not just talk. It's too much talking and not enough action.
Absolutely.
Solutions.
And it, like you just touched on it, the fact that we are, if we can't scoop them from where they are or relate to them, then it's just a canceling out each other and trying to enforce my thoughts or my belief on you instead of taking them as a friend and trying to view it together and trying to make a solution in from a common ground.
Yeah, I think that's a nice way of, but that's one of my viewpoints on how to, you know, help people to see something from a different perspective.
Yeah, but of course, it also requires that the other person is willing and open and at that same on that same frequency. To
and you got
to
know when to say, okay, my hands are up.
Exactly.
I give up.
I've done what I could.
Yeah.
I hope that answered a little bit of what you wanted to talk about, John. And before we sign off, I just want to let people know where they can find you, Robert. So I'm pulling up your links here. On Facebook, it's DJ Robert Owens. And on Instagram, it's this_is_Robert_Owens. Okay, kids, you got that? I have a few. Okay, we spoke very deep. I want to ask you a few fun trivia questions. Mm-hmm. So, and this is very, very an interesting question as well as a singer. What is Robert Owens' top five singers?
God, I never thought about it. But a lot of older ones. Let me see. Patti LaBelle.
Come on. Yes.
Luther Vandross, I loved.
Of course.
God, who else? Donny Hathaway.
Yes.
Minnie Riperton.
Mm.
Okay, who else can I? I could throw a bunch of them in there, but you know, I love Mariah Carey's voice.
Absolutely.
She's done some incredible tracks too.
She's amazing, and an amazing writer.
Yeah, I have a list of different artists there, but that's a few of them that, you know, have been really inspirational. Marvin Gaye too was another inspirational singer. That, you know, it's almost like certain people, you can almost feel their emotion and things that they went through. Lolita Holloway is another.
Yes, of course.
And you did a lot of shows with her. And, you know, we used to sit in the dressing room and, you know, just some of her conversations. I looked at her performance differently from speaking to her and talking to her. It's like I could actually feel it's like those. She lived that.
She lived that. Yeah.
She, you know, and that's beautiful when you can listen to certain singers and certain stories that they've conveyed and say, yeah, they live that. You know, I think that's beautiful when you can just put your heart on your sleeve and give it out to the public. You know, and I think that's another area where I'm saying I give unconditional love when I'm performing and I'm giving to an audience.
And we feel that for those of us who have been lucky to see you live on stage, that is what we feel.
Jocelyn Brown, another one. A lot of these entertainers, and I said I got a list of people.
Only top five, Robert.
Yeah. Okay, I'll leave it there.
All right. Favorite color?
God, my home is a fashion emporium.
I betcha. I believe. I've seen him out shopping.
I like black a lot. I probably have more black these days, and that's
because we live in Berlin.
Yeah, being introduced to the techno world and stuff. I think you can match black up with anything. You can walk into any room and not feel uncomfortable in black. You know, even you could be in a snooty rich place and still feel
calm. Chic.
And chic in your black.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Okay. This is a touring DJ question. MP3s or vinyl?
WAF. WAF Wave, however they pronounce it. WAF Wave.
WAF Wave files. Yes, right? We don't want to carry. Yeah. I mean, we love vinyls, but it's too heavy.
Yeah, and because I went to Russia and they charged me, I think, about 250-300 pounds for excess baggage.
No.
And I gave up on vinyl after that.
Oh, damn.
Like, this is like, it's a fight against, you know, the system. They're just trying to make it hard for artists traveling. And, you know, I have enough memories from the Paradise Garage days and the warehouse and music box days of, you know, playing and stuff when it was the vinyl thing. Just I think a lot of the systems today, Function 1 and beyond, these WAV files are designed for those kind of systems. And they just sound so much clearer and polished when you know you hear those files on a really good system.
Okay, what is your biggest achievement?
Being alive at this very moment.
Amen. Hold on. Yes, standing ovation for that. Being alive is a gift. Is a biggest achievement.
Because there's a whole lot of people that didn't make it.
Okay, yes.
Yeah, and you know, they just live on in our hearts, and we just try to translate their emotions and stories we know of through us and give back, you know.
Yeah. Okay, and my final question for Mr. Robert Owens, what would you like your legacy to be?
A legacy of love and sharing love and giving love to others.
Wow. That's all that matters in the end anyway, isn't it?
Yeah. That you gave, you know, you learned and you gave back to humanity.
Yeah.
Unconditionally, selflessly.
Selflessly.
You gave yourself back to humanity.
Robert Owens, I am so honored. I'm so happy for this moment that we get to share together. And thank you for letting us into your heart, into your mind, and into your amazing being, which has inspired us throughout the years of your music. But now through the short and sweet session series, you just put it into words that is all about love, inclusivity, humanity, and all the things that that binds us together.
Mm-hmm.
So thank you for this.
I'm grateful.
I am appreciative. Thank you so much. Guys, please be sure to follow and like and all that stuff. Follow Robert's amazing journey, because it's never ending with amazing music and uplifting inspirational moments. And with this, I want to say, I want to leave the kids out there with your number one hit with Fotech, Mind to Give. Do you have something you want to say about this song?
I'm just grateful. Fotech and his wife, they're beautiful people. And I love the dog. They have a beautiful dog as well.
I think I'm going to get a dog in 1 month. I'm waiting for new puppies. Right. Well, we'll see if we're really ready for it. But yeah. We love
it. It's a beautiful experience working with him and, you know, sending him love, you know, whatever he's doing in life at the moment.
Oh, wonderful. Thank you so much. I am so appreciative, Robert Owens, everybody. Thank you so much for hanging out. I'll be back again next Thursday with another inspirational artist and inspirational moments and live performance here at the Short and Sweet Session. Thank you for supporting every week. And if you enjoy this, please tell your mom, your dad, your dog, your friends, everybody around you. Till next time, stay happy, healthy, joyful. And here is Fotek and Mr. Robert Owens, Mind to Give. Much love till next week. Thank you, Robert. Thank you. Appreciate it. Thank you.
Girl.